Roger, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And on a gorgeous, beautiful, you know, Sunday, it's great to see you all out here for this, in this room with all the snow windows. So thank you for spending your day here, for the energy and for all of this. So I should ask you to reflect. I think I've been involved in this for so long. And as I'm sitting here, I'm flashing back to the profound apathy and lack of interest in this subject 10 years ago, 15 years ago among so many people. I'm flashing back to 20, 25 years ago when I was getting going, when a room like this would have been gung-ho in the drug war. Lock them up, give us treatment, lock them up, give us treatment, lock them up, yeah, give us treatment. And when that was the conventional mindset among white, black, and brown throughout this city and around the country, we've come a long way, come a very long way. I remember in the early years when the first meetings of what was called the Drug Policy Foundation, and it was basically a couple hundred white people, one or two black people, basically the academics, a few people doing needle exchange, a few people from the marijuana movement, maybe just the beginning of somebody looking at prisons. So we really have come along. We really have come along. Now, I think what it caused me to reflect on, and I said this at the DPA Biennial some months ago, I think that for us to grow, one of the things we most need to know is to be cognizant of our history. To know what we came out of, what we came from, what we came from. I was talking with Carl before about what happened recently with Black Lives Matter going after Bill Clinton for the 94 Crime Act. And part of me was overjoyed, because I remember when that Crime Act happened and how despicable it was, and all the people rallied around that. What I also remember was all the people who rallied around that, and how that was the conventional frame of a conventional Democrat, not only the outline of Republicans. We've come a long way. Now, when I think about the opening comments this morning and about what needs to happen ahead, you know, I heard Jazz's frustration. Let's stop talking about what's going through ahead. Let's try to talk about what we do instead. What's the new thing? Let's get into action. I like when Svante Myrick said, as a rare public official, make sure the people in office are doing what they need to do. Some of them can talk a sweet line. They ain't doing shit. Yeah. Some of them sound tough, but it's just cover for trying to do what's right. So focusing on what those people with power are really doing, what they're really doing to make it happen, that's pivotal. Cassandra, my colleague, said if things are going to change, it's got to be about organizing. It's got to be about mobilizing. It's got to be about getting smart. It's about getting to take the energy and the creativity and the combustion that comes out of this room today and turning it into something focused and sharp. Because as we know, you know, advocacy and effective organizing advocacy is not simply about mouthing what you think you people need to hear. It's about thinking about how you take what needs to be done and get other people to do what needs to be done when you do not possess all the power, when you possess a part of the power, when you have to magnify your power. Now, we're doing that in more and more places around the country, and I'm proud of my colleagues who are involved in doing that in different states. But that element of organizing in a disciplined way and tapping into, because something's happening right now, I mean, I remember, it always seemed like every decade, each new generation coming into their late teens and 20s was as apathetic as the group before. But that's not true this generation. There's something new going on here. And I just hope that the next generation, 10 years from now, is even more so that way. Although I've seen enough waves going down, whether we have to roll with what we got. I also heard Carl say, come out of the closet already about your drug use. About who you are. It's a long time with nobody to come out. Then the only people who could come out for a long time were people who had fucked up on drugs and they were clean and sober in sobriety and God bless them. Yes, God bless them. But they were the only ones entitled to have a voice. The people who were using and continuing to use, and whether they were struggling or whether they were thriving, were not allowed to have a voice. They were not allowed to speak about the positive roles that drugs played in their life or about the ambivalent roles that they played. You know, 50 years ago, everybody in America knew a homosexual. They just didn't know they knew a homosexual. And therefore, their image of who was a homosexual was what they read about in the newspapers, or somebody being arrested in a men's room, or somebody who was flamboyantly gay, or whatever it might be, right? Now, and for 5 or 10 years and more now, everybody in America knows a homosexual. They know somebody who is gay, or lesbian, or trans, or whatever it might be. And because they know these people, because now they know them, that they're cousins, and their siblings, and their coworkers, and their bosses, and their employees, and their friends, and all this, right, it becomes so much more difficult to discriminate and to have outrageous assumptions out there. Well, the same thing is true about all of us who use drugs. Our ability, our willingness to find the ways to come out. Yeah, Ashu was right. Gotta be careful. Because lots of people here still work in places where you get drug tested. Lots of people here still have children and can worry about losing their kids. Or if they got a criminal record, worry about losing their kids. Lots of people. Right? Lots of people worry about, oh my God, if it's out that I'm a drug user, well then when my friend goes over to, when my kid goes over to his kid's house and their parents are going to say, they can't go to my house because his parents have it. So we know it's there. But figuring out the ways in which we take the risks to come out, to open up, whether it's just in our family and just that small world, and to be open, to educate people older, to normalize that, that too is the element. And you know, I love the way Art led that conversation about the drug dealers, the drug sellers. Because they're called dealers, right? We know that dealers is a negative word, right? Drug sellers, right? Drug entrepreneurs. And it's a complicated issue. Because, you know, even when you make something legal, as we know from the case of Eric Garner, it doesn't mean people are still not going to get busted for selling outside of that legally regulated system. But it does mean you're removing the core. You're removing the core. You're removing the core of this thing. Now, how do we think about people who sell drugs? Art tried to raise that question. Sometimes internally we have a conversation of, you know, if you're talking about policing, how you police drug markets, the real distinction you have to make is not between people who use drugs and people who sell drugs, right? The bottom line is nobody uses drugs to be punished simply because they put it in their body after harm to others, and that's a bottom line core principle, that nobody deserves to be punished because they put it in their body, not what they look like, sound like, smell like, whatever, as long as they're not hurting anybody else. But when it comes to people who sell, I have to say, my perspective has always been that we do make a distinction among people who sell drugs. And maybe that distinction is less about whether it's legal or illegal in addition to selling. It's whether it's, excuse my French, whether they're an asshole drug dealer or a non-asshole drug dealer. Are they taking pride in the quality of the product they sell? Or are they selling shit that's going to hurt people? With all these new soy guys not giving a damn what it's cut with, what it's done with, what it's going to do to people. Are they selling to people and trying to rip them off, or are they doing it square? Are they doing it in a way that's respectful of community norms and understand that they're providing for a market in the community? Or are they exploiting and trying to grow? Are they strutting it down the street, intimidating people? Or are they trying to be polite to the environment and the community in which they live? The whole notion that we got to get the drug dealers out of town, we don't get the drug dealers out of town. As long as you want to buy drugs, there's going to be want to sell it. And the question is going to be, what are the conditions under which they're going to sell it? Well, if we want to make it legal, that's going to come with the things that we began to talk about on the marijuana market. But if we're going to keep it illegal, we still have to make a distinction about how people are going to do that. Are they going to respect the consumer? Are they going to respect their neighbor? Are they going to respect society in providing the substance for which there is a market? Whether that market is the person who is addicted to that substance, or whether that's the person who's just using it casually and responsible, whatever it might be. It seems to be that, because in a way, we're ultimately talking about what it means to have a decent drug policy. A decent one, a fair one. One that treats fellow human beings the way, you know, you would want your children treated, the way you would want to be treated. Right? Whether ultimately, you know, we tend to think that we want to reduce the role of criminalization and the criminal justice system and drug control as much as possible, that there is no inherent reason why this system of drug control needs to be a fundamentally criminalized system. We do have a moral obligation and a policy imperative to move away from a reliance on criminalization to a different type of frame. But as we make that evolution, the guiding principles have to be how we treat fellow human beings. What type of society do we have? Are we respecting individual freedom and simultaneously respecting the norms of the community in terms of the public places that it cares about? Now, that last question, Susan Vernon, I'm sorry I cannot give you dispensary license.
Oh, shucks.
Quite frankly, I'm not a business person, and I don't know how to do that stuff. And as Art said, you know, it's hard to put, you know, all of the economic inequality and the racial inequality and the way capital is distributed on drug policy reform. What I can tell you is that for We Drug Policy Alliance, we will at least make the good faith effort. We can't take on all of America's capitalism. I don't think anybody can. And maybe one day some of you, some of us, will lead the revolution that will change this. But I can tell you we can try. And so I'll tell you why I'm proud of what we did in California. California's marijuana legalization initiative, it is going to be the first one that really takes on these issues. It is the first legalization initiative that explicitly says that people who have had a felony conviction will have a chance to participate in the legal market. That's big. Can't get a license to sell booze if you've had a criminal conviction. So we're going beyond where alcohol was. People talk a lot about reparations. This initiative actually has reparations in it. With a significant portion of the tax revenue being generated by this initiative is going to communities that have been harmed by the drug war. And we got that into that initiative. You're not going to see us singing about it when we're going the final stretch of the campaign, because we don't think that element in the initiative is what's going to win over the suburban moms, you know, whatever voter. But it is in there, and you should know it. And when it comes to helping people clean their criminal records of prior convictions, this, too, initiative is going to go further than anyone ever did before. But I'm telling you something else. The future is, we are trying to move a system from a prohibition system to a non-prohibition system. We cannot control that. We, EPA, we, the broader movement. I would say that if California wins and some of the other legalization issues win this time, our influence over all this is going to diminish and diminish, because quite frankly, the people who are going to make money from this thing are going to be making money, and they're going to be driving these things on their own. We can set a model, but the ability to ensure that the model we're providing in California becomes a model for other states around the country is going to depend upon our capacity to mobilize. Now, and if the money is going to be distributed beyond the ways that we are trying to do in this initiative, you can change the law, but also there's other things at play. We can't provide the answers for how to mobilize capital, although we can try to do things that help to get that moving, but in the end, I think ending prohibition, I mean, this is where I'm just going to finish with these words. I got involved in this a long time ago because it seemed to me that the war on drugs and the prohibitionist laws and institutions and mindsets in which it was embedded were a fundamental evil in our society. That's what moved me. That the notion that I could live in a state where almost half the people going to prison were going there for a Rockefeller drug law violation, where people could think that we were enforcing drug laws that were grounded in science, but in fact they were grounded in racism of the 19th and 20th century, right? That's what moved me. When we mobilized in New York, and you can see that 95, 96% of all the people locked up in New York State prison, the Rockefeller drug law violation, were black or brown, even though that had no resemblance to the percent that were actually dealing it, when you can look in Los Angeles County and not one non-minority person was prosecuted for a crack cocaine violation for years after those laws were imposed, you know that this thing was permeated with racism, you know. And so I have remained and will remain focused on undoing and draining the power and force from prohibitionist laws in our society. I will, and DPA will remain committed to opening up and transforming the notions and the bigotry and ignorance around drug use and drug users that stands in the way of serious drug policy reform, even among people who say that they are committed to criminal justice reform. Because we can't let our own prejudice and ignorance stand in the way of going where we need to go. We cannot on our own solve the challenges of American capitalism, but we can take this monstrosity known as the drug war that has resulted in the incarceration of millions and the arrest of tens of millions, disproportionately people of color, black and brown and poor, and we can drag that thing out of our society in a way. Will other things replace it? I bet they will. Will anything ever be able to replace it with the force of the drug war in the 1980s, 90s, the past decade? No, it will not. Because it was a peculiarly, particularly pernicious system that played on everything that was fearful and wrong in our society. We can uproot that. Today was a wonderful day. Deborah, the words you said about Asha were so true. And I am so grateful and delighted to have you here.